which will be on aggregation and growth in granular materials by Sanjay Puri from JNU. Sanjay.
Well, friends, I should start off by thanking the organizers for this invitation to be here. Both the schedule for both the conference and the school are really excellent, and it's an honor to be part of such a good program. I have this long-standing interest in granular materials or granular matter, and I've sort of prepared a talk which covers some of my interests in this area. One will encounter very many examples of aggregation growth, not nucleation, but aggregation and growth in granular matter. And I'll try to sort of stress some of these examples as we go on. Okay. So I have a very general title, Pattern Formation in Granular Materials. Okay, so here's an overview of my talk. I'll start off with a brief introduction to granular matter, just sort of give you a few transparencies on what, why this interest in granular matter. The large bulk of my talk will focus on granular gases. Okay, so this is a rarefied system of granular particles. And I am interested in the dynamical properties of granular matter. In particular, we will be looking at the free cooling of granular gases. Okay, in this case, what cooling means is essentially the particles undergo inelastic collisions. They lose energy in these collisions. And that cooling is equated with the loss of kinetic energy through these collisions. Okay, so as we'll see, the granular gases start off by cooling in a homogeneous state. I start off with a homogeneous system. Then they enter a clustering or aggregating state, and one will sort of discuss at some length how the cooling process proceeds. Okay, the homogeneous cooling state is usually referred to as the HCS in the literature. The inhomogeneous cooling state is referred to as the ICS. I'll spend some time discussing velocity distributions and long time tails in both the homogeneous and inhomogeneous cooling states. One of the big deals about granular matter has been what is the nature of velocity distributions in these systems. Invariably, these velocity distributions turn out to be non-Maxwell-Boltzmann. Okay, so I'll spend a certain amount of time discussing these properties. Depending on how much time I have left, I'll discuss the same cooling problem, but in the context of what are called viscoelastic granular gases. In viscoelastic granular gases, up to this point, up to D, the collisions between grains will be characterized by a constant coefficient of restitution. Okay? In viscoelastic gases, the coefficient of restitution will actually depend on the velocity of approach of the colliding particles. And then I'll end with my conclusion. And I've tried to keep the talk at a reasonably pedagogical and self-contained level, keeping in mind that there's many students attending this workshop. Okay, so we're all familiar with granular materials or powders. We encounter it every time we walk on the beach. So examples of granular matter, the most popular one, of course, is sand, glass beads, metal medicine capsules, what have you. And these are typically large thermodynamic assemblies of inelastic particles. Okay, so I'm going to discuss dynamical properties of granular materials. And for me, one of the most important crucial properties will be that they undergo inelastic collisions. And this will sort of enter in various ways as time goes on. Okay, the typical size of these particles is 10 microns to a centimeter. I've already said that the particles dissipate energy on collision. Keep in mind that this dissipation of energy is equated with cooling. Okay, usual thermal temperature is not meaningful in the granular context. So the typical, the average kinetic energy is what we interpret as temperature. And if the average kinetic energy goes down, the particles dissipate energy, the system undergoes cooling. Typically, again, we're interested in sort of a limit where the scale of the assembly, let's say a sand dune, for example, is much larger than the particle size. Two sort of caveats out here. The first is that because the particle size is mesoscopic, there will be quite a few properties at the macro scale which depend on the shape, size, nature of the constituent particle. Okay, so that's usual. That's different from our usual statistical physics. Various properties will depend upon the shape and the size of the particles, and there's going to be less universality at the macro level. Nevertheless, there is universality, and in this talk, I will try to sort of elucidate some of that universality. Granular materials or powders have been studied by engineers for a couple of centuries already. The physicist's interest dates to about 30, 40 years back. An early influential paper was by this RevMod physics article by Jaeger, Nagel, and Beringer. So this is from 1996. There's these biannual powders and grains conferences, which sort of update you on the state of the art in granular matter. And I've been reading this book a lot recently, and now, as a matter of fact, we're even collaborating with Brilliantov. I've been reading this book in the context of what is now called the kinetic theory of granular gases, or inelastic kinetic theory. Okay, so this is a generalization of your usual kinetic theory to the case where you have inelastic particles. Okay, so I already said that I'm going to focus on dynamical problems for granular matter. There's been lots of interest in static problems, how sand piles form, what is the angle of repose, what is a stress distribution, and so on and so forth. And of course, Professor Deepak Dhar will discuss some of these problems in the next talk, I take it. I will focus on dynamical problems, and there are two classes of dynamical problems. Let me quickly sort of run you through them. In the first class, so we've already got that granular particles dissipate energy on collision, right? So that's sort of the key property. So the first class of problems, you continuously input energy to compensate the energy lost due to the inelastic collisions, okay? And the typical ways of inputting energy are engineering dictated. For example, lots of people rotate granular matter in a drum. Others vibrate it on a plate horizontally, vertically. You can flow it, you can pour it, and so on and so forth. Okay. In this class of problems, the sort of general goal is that you're the general sort of paradigm is that you're losing energy due to inelastic collisions. You input energy by agitating the granular matter, and thereby put the system into a non-equilibrium steady state. And then one wants to study the pattern dynamics and sort of characteristic morphologies which arise in these non-equilibrium steady states. Okay, I've had a lot of interest in the first two problems out here, and for a few transparencies, I'll discuss rotation in a drum. But the bulk of my talk will focus on the free evolution of an initially homogeneous granular gas. Okay, so you just consider a granular gas, it's homogeneous. The particles undergo collisions. The collisions make the system cool down. It loses energy and ultimately dies. But what happens in the process of going from the homogeneous state to the dead state of the granular material? Okay, so the large bulk of the talk will be focused on these problems. Again, they've been of great interest to many people, and I'll mention some more references as we go along. Okay, but let's spend a little time looking at a system which is energized by the input of energy, which is agitated by an external mechanism. Okay. So here's my first example of granular matter in a rotating drum. You see this on a construction site. You see this experiment done every day. In this case, the drum is, well, there's my schematic of a drum. The radius of the drum is capital R, and it's half filled with, let's say, sand for specificity, and gravity points in the downward direction, and this drum is rotated with angular velocity omega in one direction, okay? Now, if the angular velocity is very large, the sand is fluidized throughout the cross-section of the drum, right? So that's not a limit we're interested in. Equally well, if the angular velocity of rotation is small, there's a stick-slip motion of the sand in the bottom of the drum, okay? We're interested in an intermediate range of frequencies where the following non-equilibrium steady state applies. You have a solid bulk which accretes particles onto the surface. The surface is a laminar layer. Particles sort of flow down this way and then sort of deplete back into the bulk. So there's a steady state S-shaped surface profile obtained by balancing the accretion depletion from the bulk with flow in the laminar layer, basically. Okay, and I just want to sort of emphasize that one often hears the statement that granular matter is both solid and fluid, right? So this is actually an example of a system where the solid and the fluid coexist together. One can understand the nature of this S-shaped profile. Let me sort of briefly run you through the sort of arguments that apply. So let's say I have this coordinate x along the sort of radial direction. It goes from minus R, 0, to plus R. At the edge of the drum, essentially I have no current of matter to transport down, okay? So I'm essentially at my natural repose angle at the edge of the drum. As I go sort of further down, closer to the center, the current of particles to be transported becomes larger and larger. So the sort of S-shaped surface profile becomes steeper. It's steepest at the center, where you're transporting the largest amount of material down the granular, down the laminar layer. Okay? Then as I start again moving away from the center, I deplete particles to the bulk, so the slope becomes less and less. And finally, I come back to my natural repose angle at the surface. Okay, so that's the physics that goes into it. It's sort of encapsulated in this equation, which we obtained quite a while ago. Again, let me just run you through this equation, or at least through the solution. It's a cubic equation. There's material parameters out here. Tan of theta is the local slope of this S-shaped profile. If there's no frequency of rotation, tan of the local slope is equal to mu, which is known as the Coulombic friction coefficient. That is just the natural repose angle of a sand pile. As I start rotating the drum, this side becomes non-zero. At x equal to plus r, this term drops out again. So again, I'm at natural repose. Tan theta is equal to mu. At x equal to minus r, this term drops out again. I'm at natural repose. And at the center of the drum, this S-shaped surface profile is the steepest. Okay. So far, we're just talking of one component granular matter, sand, in a rotating drum. Okay, let me just quickly show you some experimental pictures. These are obtained from Steve Lipson at Technion in Israel. And I just want to sort of show you that, again, this point, if I go back to this cubic equation, there's material parameters, but then this S-shaped surface profile is generic. And actually, one sees that in experiments on different systems. So here's, again, these are drums half full of the granular matter specified out here. These are being rotated in the clockwise direction, unlike my schematic, which was being rotated in the counterclockwise direction. But characteristically, you see this S-shaped surface profile, S-shaped profile, and whether the profile is steeper or how much it is modulated depends on the material parameters of the system. Okay, so that's so far no talk of aggregation. One is just talking of one component granular matter. The story doesn't end here. It's actually it's quite a fascinating system. Lots of people have done experiments with granular mixtures. Let's say you're looking at a mixture of sand and glass, or more generically, you're looking at a mixture of a rough material and a smooth material. You put these in a drum and start rotating them. So at time t equal to zero, you have, a homogeneous mixture of sand and glass. On the time scale of a few drum rotations, let's say five drum rotations, you get a radial segregation where the rough material, sand, comes to the center of the drum and the smooth material goes to the wings of the drum. Okay, so this is a radial segregation. Well, this state persists for a while. You keep rotating the drum. Say at 1,000 sort of drum rotations, you have a Taylor instability. The Taylor instability destabilizes the flat interface, and the system evolves into alternating bands of sand, which are red, and glass, which are yellow, and so on and so forth. And as time goes on, these bands coarsen exceedingly slowly with time. Okay, so I just want to sort of use this slide to make a couple of points. This is, for those who have seen such pictures before, is very reminiscent of a phase separation phenomenon. It's like a phase separation of sand and glass. Okay, in a usual phase separation problem, you have a situation where there's surface tension between A and B. That's what drives A and B apart. In this case, of course, there's no surface tension. These are mesoscopic objects, okay? So the point I want to make here is, and we actually use this to model the system, that the kinetics in this case, the inelastic collisions, give something akin to a surface tension. We actually realized, this is Hayakawa and myself, that you can write down a phenomenological model for the evolution of the system, which is based on the propensity of rougher materials to have a steeper natural angle of repose. Okay, that's basically the ingredient of the model. And then one finds that this is very much like a one-dimensional phase separation problem. And we predicted that the bands should grow logarithmically with time, a prediction which was later confirmed by experiments. Okay, so the message to take away from this transparency is that though there's no surface tension in the sense of particles A and B disliking each other, there is a kinetically generated surface tension which gives rise to aggregation and growth in these systems. Okay, and this one we'll see sort of cropping up repeatedly in subsequent slides also. Well, people have done things with three-component granular mixtures and what have you. I'm not going to go into the details of that. I should mention that one of the prime persons who's done experiments with granular matter in drums is a colleague of ours, that's Devang Thakkar, in the Chemical Engineering Department of IIT Bombay. And now we actually also have a joint student who's sort of right here. Okay, so that's my first set of statements. Remember, we're talking about dynamical problems. The most crucial thing in some sense is that they undergo inelastic collisions. In one, I drive the system into a non-equilibrium steady state by agitating it. And this was an example, this was exemplified by rotation in a drum. Now I'm going to move on to the second class of problems where I consider an initially homogeneous granular gas. It's not driven in any manner, so ultimately it's going to die. And I want to see what happens in the process of death. Okay? So that's for the rest of the talk, we'll just talk about freely evolving granular gases. So here's my schematic of a granular gas. And as I said, I start off with a homogeneous system. Here's a schematic of a granular collision. Particle I comes in, that's the black particle out here. Particle J comes in, that's the red particle. They undergo a collision when they impact. The collision depends upon the in the collision, the relative normal velocity is dissipated. So they come out a little more parallel to each other than before the collision, okay? So that's sort of the schematic of what's going on. I've written down the velocities before and after the collision here. These are extremely simple to obtain. This is a Resnick and Halliday type of problem. Basically, what goes into this is that you conserve momentum and you dissipate the normal component of the velocity, okay? So what you find is that the velocity of particle I after the collision is equal to the velocity of I before the collision minus E is this all-important coefficient of restitution. In the usual elastic case, which we do, which we normally do, E is equal to 1. For the granular case, E is less than 1. N hat is the normal sort of vector from pointing from one center to another. This is obviously the normal component of the relative velocity. Okay, I'm just considering particles with equal mass, equal size, etc. So if you just multiply both sides by the mass and add them up, this term cancels with this term, and you see that the momentum after the collision is the same as the momentum before the collision. Okay, so this E is the all-important sort of characteristic of the collision. For the moment, I will take it to be constant. Okay, subsequently, we will relax this constraint. And so the restitution coefficient E is equal to 1 in the usual elastic case, which I will always use sort of as a reference point to sort of understand what's happening in the inelastic case, and is less than 1 in the inelastic case. In the limit E equal to 0, the particles just sort of stick together after collision. Okay, so this is what's called the sticky inelastic gas. In the sticky inelastic gas, I and J just sort of stick together after collision and then move parallel to each other. Okay, now this simple process is actually going to give rise to a great deal of physics. Think of it the following way, that unlike your usual inelastic collisions, correlations are getting built up in the system. Okay, how do correlations get built up? Well, these particles are somewhat more parallel to each other than when they went in. This fellow collides with something out there. This fellow collides with something out there. Subsequent to the collision, they're a little more parallel, and so on and so forth. So at each collision, some correlations build into the system, and that's what's going to give rise to all the physics. A couple of observations out here. I think I basically said these statements already. Obviously, the density is conserved. Two particles in, two particles out. The momentum is conserved. I just told you that's sort of the cardinal principle. And the magnitude of the normal velocity is reduced for E less than 1. This loss of kinetic energy is what I will refer to as cooling. And I will equate the average kinetic energy as the average temperature of the system. Okay, so that's one thing that's happening. The system is cooling. I started off with a homogeneous system. So obviously, it's going to cool at least for some time in a homogeneous state. And the second and even more important thing is that the velocities have become parallelized by these repeated collisions, and correlations are building up in the system. And these correlations will ultimately drive the system into a clustered or aggregated state. Okay, so I'm going to run you through a quick sort of schematic calculation of how, a quick calculation of how the system cools in the homogeneous cooling state. Again, I'm repeating this, but remember you have a homogeneous system. You start with the particles undergo inelastic collisions as so. So I can calculate the initial kinetic energy and the final kinetic energy and sort of figure out how much is the loss of energy per collision. Okay, so here's my calculation. The fraction of energy lost per collision depends on, if you just sort of do the calculation, it comes out to be 1 minus E squared. E equal to 1 is the elastic limit, so no energy is lost in the elastic limit. Okay, so that's the numerator, and the denominator is D, the dimensionality. You lose energy in the normal direction and don't lose energy in the other D minus 1 dimensions. Okay, so that's where the factor 1 over D comes from. And I'll rewrite this 1 minus E squared as epsilon. Okay, so remember, epsilon equal to 0 is the elastic limit. Epsilon further and further from 0 is the more and more inelastic case. The temperature, I've already told you, is defined as the average kinetic energy. So the rate of cooling, or the rate of loss of average kinetic energy, is a minus sign. The system is cooling. This factor, epsilon by D, which is a fraction of energy lost per collision, the frequency of collision at temperature T, and the temperature T itself. Okay, this is again a very sort of a simple equation. And the collision frequency one just takes from the kinetic theory of hard spheres. That's proportional to the density. Let's forget about this factor. Sigma is the diameter and the square root of temperature. You can just get this expression from dimensional analysis. Okay, so basically I plug omega into here, integrate this equation up, and I come up with the first result that was obtained by Hoff many years ago, that the temperature of the system as a function of time cools in this manner. So T0 is the initial temperature, and this denominator is what characterizes the cooling. Okay, it's always nice to go back to the elastic limit and reassure yourself that everything is okay in the elastic limit. In the elastic limit, E is 1, epsilon is 0, so this term simply drops out, and as you expect, the temperature at all times is the same as the initial temperature for an inelastic hard sphere gas. Okay, so that's the Haas cooling law. Let me just introduce quickly one more concept out here. That is the concept of the collision time. So the collision time is essentially the number of collisions a particle has undergone up to time t. Remember, the system's mean squared velocity is coming down. It's cooling, right? So the system is going to become more and more sluggish with time. Okay. So the collision time factors in the fact that it's becoming more sluggish. If I plug this expression for omega in here, I find that the collision time goes logarithmically with the real time. Okay. So if t grows in a certain manner, the collision time, because the system is becoming more sluggish, grows logarithmically with that. How do I get back to the elastic limit? Always useful. In the elastic limit, E is equal to 1, epsilon is 0. I tailor expand this log 1 plus whatever, and the 2d by epsilon cancels with the epsilon by 2d, and the collision time is just the collision frequency times the real time. Again, very reasonable sort of going back to the elastic limit. Why I've introduced this collision time is because this Haas cooling law has a very elegant sort of form in collision time. It's simply this expression out here, temperature or average kinetic energy as a function of collision time is the initial temperature exponential minus this factor epsilon by d tau. Okay, so all this argumentation has assumed that the system is homogeneous. That went into my calculation of the fraction of energy lost per collision, because I assumed sort of the particles were coming in randomly oriented to each other. Okay, so in the homogeneous cooling state, the temperature decays exponentially with the collision time, and this factor epsilon decays how the slope of the exponent. So the next thing I'm going to do is actually show you a test of this Haas cooling law. Done by molecular dynamics simulations. So here's a test of half-schooling law. So these are done with, normally in this case, one does what are called event-driven simulations, and you can deal with the literally million or 10 million particles, because you only have to keep track of the collisions between the particles. You don't have to integrate the sort of Newton's equations of motion, including an interaction potential. Okay. So here's results from event-driven simulations. The density of the gas is approximately 0.2. Well, it's 0.2. Here's the temperature as a function of time. Collision time is what I'm talking about now. So here's the temperature as a function of collision time. In the elastic limit where E is equal to 1, the temperature is just that flat line out there, right? Basically, the system doesn't cool with time. As I turn on the inelasticity, so this is, well, some amount of inelasticity, I see that my data decays exponentially with the collision time for a while. This solid line is the Hough's law plotted here. So my data sort of goes down with the Hough's law, but then deviates away from the Hough's law. So a natural question is that this very simple argument, what's gone wrong with it? Why has the Hough's law ceased to hold after a certain crossover time? And the answer, as you'll find out shortly, is that the system undergoes aggregation and there's clustering and the growth of these clusters. At larger values of the inelasticity, remember E equal to 1 is the elastic limit. Again, I find the same broad feature that the system decays initially with the Hough's law and then deviates away from the Hough's law. And the deviation is faster for higher values of the inelasticity. Okay, so there's a crossover from a homogeneous cooling state, which we now fully understand, to an inhomogeneous cooling state, which I will next discuss. And that crossover depends on inversely on the inelasticity. It's faster for higher inelasticity, and it's also faster for higher densities of the system. Higher density, in some sense, gives you a larger frequency of collisions, obviously. Okay, so that's the Hough's cooling law. So the statement so far is that the system, I started off with a homogeneous granular gas. It cools initially in a homogeneous state and then deviates away from that homogeneous state. Let's now talk about the inhomogeneous cooling state, right? So what happened to this granular gas that was cooling, which sort of made it unstable to density fluctuations? Well, here's a sort of a typical argument as to why this happens. Consider a homogeneous granular gas, okay? Let's say there's a density fluctuation in it. In the regions where the density becomes higher, the collisions are more frequent, the system cools more rapidly, and the pressure becomes less, and so you suck particles into the regions with higher density. Okay, so this is what's called a negative diffusion instability, which is well known to us from our studies of phase separation and other aggregation problems. Okay, so in this case, again, it's purely kinetic. There is no sort of molecular interaction potential, etc., which is going to drive the aggregation. Negative diffusion is a consequence of the fact that denser regions cool faster, the pressure becomes lower, and they suck neighboring particles into them. You can also do a linear stability analysis of the corresponding hydrodynamic equations. You have these nonlinear hydrodynamic equations for granular gases, and identify that the instabilities are due to a shear mode and a heat mode. But for us, this argument is good enough. Negative diffusion occurs because denser particles, denser regions, cool faster, and thereby suck in more particles, okay? So therefore, after a certain crossover time, the granular gas goes from the homogeneous cooling state. So it's going to continue to cool because each collision loses energy. But after a crossover time, the granular gas is now going to cool in an inhomogeneous cooling state, okay? So here's a snapshot from our molecular dynamic simulations. This sort of illustrates the entire process. Remember, this is a free gas, okay? I'm not agitating it anyway. There's no potentials and so on and so forth. I start off at collision time. I'll now just talk in terms of collision time. At time t equal to 0 in a homogeneous state somewhere up there, I allow the system to sort of evolve. Kinetically, it loses energy. At 10 collision times, this is for E equal to 0.9. At 10 collision times, you don't really see any clustering processes or anything of the sort. As at 100 collision times, you start to see the emergence of clusters. And at 1,000 collision times, you see the well-demarcated growth formation and growth of clusters. And again, as in the rotating drum problem, there's no surface tension in here. It is generated kinetically by the correlations that build up when the particles undergo these inelastic collisions. Okay, this is very analogous to a phase separation problem, right? This is like the phase separation of a density field. And as a matter of fact, Subir Das and I exploited this analogy to understand various features of this morphology, including the structure factors, the correlation functions, the growth laws that characterize these morphologies, and so on and so forth. Okay, so far I've been talking of the density field. Let me also make a few observations about the velocity field, right? This is a fluid. There's also a velocity field. So here's my snapshots of the evolving velocity field. At time zero, I have a homogeneous random system with a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. So in that homogeneous system, I have randomly oriented velocity vectors. At 10 collision units, I don't really see any structures has emerged. These are sort of little arrows out here. But then as time goes on, I see the emergence of vortices and anti-vortices in this velocity field, okay? And the sort of coarsening process is characterized by the collision and annealing of these vortices and anti-vortices, except keep in mind that the momentum is conserved. So overall, at the end, you must have a, if you start off with a zero overall momentum state, at the end also you must have a zero overall momentum. And this ordering, as we realize, that this was very akin to the phase separation of a density field, this is very akin to the phase separation of a vector field, okay? And typically the place where we encounter that in our studies of phase ordering dynamics is if you look at a superconductor, let's consider a superconductor in the normal state, okay? You suddenly quench the superconductor down below the superconducting temperature. In equilibrium, the system will have a macroscopic phase angle, which is the same everywhere. Basically, okay, how does it proceed to get to that uniform macroscopic phase angle from the initial random state? Well, it does it precisely as is stated out here. It does so by the annealing of vortices, anti-vortices, monopoles, depending on what the dimensionality is. And a long time ago, Alan Bray and myself actually understood the kinetics of annealing of a vector field, or how vector defects drive phase ordering, and we found again, Subir and I, that the sort of whole the structure factor, correlation function, growth laws, etc., are recovered precisely from the analogous phase ordering scenario. Again, keep in mind that there's no cost for a defect out here. A vortex doesn't cost energy. That's why it goes away in the usual superconductor. Here, simply the sort of local parallelization eliminates the vortices and the anti-vortices as time proceeds. Okay, so that's what one keeps in mind. Okay, so I would say that we have a pretty good understanding of the homogeneous cooling state, the morphology of the inhomogeneous cooling state, the velocity field, the density field, and so on and so forth. Okay, I now want to move on to a sort of problems which have also intrigued us, and this concerns the velocity distributions in the homogeneous cooling state and the inhomogeneous cooling state. Okay, so this is a. So now again, I'm going to go back to my evolution out here. I am now going to focus on the velocity distribution in the homogeneous cooling state. Okay, so I'm not going to think about when aggregation takes place. I'm just going to focus on the period before the system starts to aggregate and go into this inhomogeneous cooling state, okay? So let's talk about the velocity distributions in the homogeneous cooling state. And as I said, one of the big deals in granular matter is that the Maxwell-Boltzmann, if you take an elastic hard sphere system and you just let it collide in a few collisions per particle, it will cross over to a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. How do you prove this? You write down the corresponding Boltzmann transport equation and you find its steady state solution to be the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. Well, typically for granular matter, the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution of the elastic case becomes non-Maxwell-Boltzmann, okay? And the situation is sort of even more complex in that the distribution that arises experimentally depends on the particular situation which you're looking at. So it's different in a rotating drum, it's different in a vibrated granular matter. So now I want to investigate this problem of the velocity distribution in the context of my cooling granular gas. Okay, so that's the question I'm going to ask myself. Again, it's always useful to have the sort of elastic state as a reference state. So I'm just talking about the homogeneous cooling state. Now, if I have an elastic elastic hard sphere gas, after a few collisions, I go into a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. Here's the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution written for arbitrary dimensionality, D. And it's simply, of course, we all know this form. The important factor out here is this V0 squared, or the mean squared velocity, right? That's what characterizes my granular gas, and that's what's related to the temperature. Okay, the corresponding solution for the granular gas, the most reasonable ansatz is the following. One, you know that for the granular gas, V0 squared is diminishing with time, okay? So I replace V0 squared by a time-dependent V0, right? It's cooling according to this Hough's law that I already know, okay? So I propose the following scaling solution for the granular velocity distribution. V0 squared has now become time dependent, and I generalize the function exp to some arbitrary function f, and you can actually get this scaling solution out of this inelastic version of the Boltzmann transport equation. That's what is very well discussed in this book. And the typical function that people in the fluid mechanics literature take is as so. I'm not going to go into the details of this function. Basically, the leading term is the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, as you expect. And then there's Sonnin polynomials multiplied by Sonnin coefficients. In the Maxwell-Boltzmann elastic limit, all the Sonnin coefficients except for the first one are zero. The first one is simply one because I just have the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. In the granular case, I expect that I will, I will pick up some deviations from the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. Okay, so as I said, I don't want to go into the details of this expansion too much. I've just written down the first few terms out here. That's the first Sonnin polynomial. Its coefficient is guaranteed to be 1 in all cases. That's a that's a zeroth. That's the first Sonnin polynomial. Its coefficient is guaranteed to be 0 in all cases, okay? So the first non-trivial Sonnin coefficient is A2 in this expansion. Again, I don't want to sort of belabor this point too much, but just keep in mind that elastic case, A1 is equal to 1, A0 is equal to 1, A1, A2, A3, etc. are all 0. Departures from Maxwell-Boltzmann will be quantified by the values of A2, A3, A4, etc., okay? As I said, you can actually calculate these Sonnin coefficients from kinetic theory. The first such calculations were done by Matthew Ernst and his group. Now we've done, Matthew did only calculations of this first non-trivial Sonnin coefficient A2. It's this ugly expression. The important point of this expression is that at E equal to 1, the elastic limit, A2 becomes identically 0, as you expect, because you expect to go over to the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution in the elastic limit. We've also recently done calculations of A2 and A3. These are even more ugly, as a matter of fact, and I'm not going to sort of show them to you. But again, they have this obvious property, must have, that in the elastic limit, all these coefficients become identically 0. Okay, so here's here's a sort of picture of the velocity distribution what I plotted here is actually the speed distribution in the homogeneous cooling state. I'm showing you results for various values of the inelasticity. These times are chosen so that I am lying in the homogeneous cooling state. By lying in the homogeneous cooling state, I mean that the Hough's cooling law applies for these times. Let's first focus on this result for E equal to 0.95. This is the nearly elastic limit. The circles are our numerical data, very accurate because we have very large size systems and average over large runs, large number of runs. And the solid line is the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. I've plotted this on a semi-log plot. On a direct plot, you actually see no difference between the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution and the granular gas numerically obtained distribution. The difference arises in the tail. As you can see, there's a systematic deviation of the granular distribution numerically obtained from the Maxwell-Boltzmann tail. And this dashed line is actually a Sonin coefficient expansion, right? So it goes right through the numerically obtained granular distribution. That's the general broad feature. Another value of inelasticity, again, on a direct plot, you would see no difference between the numerical data and the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. The difference shows up in terms of the slight departure of the tail, and again, it is captured spot on by our Sonin polynomial expansion up to order A3. Okay, so that's the first two non-trivial Sonin coefficients. Okay, so maybe I can just sort of say a little bit about this. We've also looked at how the Sonin coefficients behave as a function of collision time. So I start off at collision time t equal to 0 with a homogeneous gas with a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. So A2 is identically 0. As time goes on, it relaxes to its inelastic kinetic theory value, which is this dashed line out here, and then slowly reverts back to 0. In the inhomogeneous cooling state, which just consists of random clusters of things moving in arbitrary directions, we expect to recover a Gaussian distribution or a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. Okay, but we haven't sort of observed clearly the numerics where A2, A3, etc., all relax back to 0. Okay. Okay, so that's sort of, I'm not going to talk about aging in long-time tails. I briefly want to discuss, how much time do I have? 10 minutes? Yeah. I briefly want to discuss a recent work with Brilliantov, who's an expert on inelastic kinetic theory, where we've been looking at viscoelastic granular gases, okay? So if you go back to the first picture I had showed of the granular collision, particle I comes in, particle J comes in, and then they come out a little more parallel after the collision and before the collision. And how much of the normal velocity is dissipated depends on the restitution coefficient E. So I have exactly the same collision rule, except in a more realistic situation. And the first person I studied this systematically was C.V. Raman, who considered collisions of various steel balls and glass balls and wooden balls and so on and so forth. So the restitution coefficient is an expansion as a function of the normal velocity around, it's some departure from 1. Okay, so the normal velocity is 0, E is equal to 1. That's like an elastic collision, as a matter of fact. And then as this becomes larger and larger, then you have more and more departure from the elastic case. Okay, the key point to be noted here is, remember that in my cooling process, the particles are sort of colliding with each other and dissipating the normal velocity. Okay, so this collision will become more and more elastic in the late stages of the collision process. Okay, as opposed to my previous granular gas, which continued to have the same value of E, regardless of how late you were into the aggregation process. Okay, so the key parameter out here is something called delta. I don't sort of want to go too much into the details of this, but basically we've studied cooling, inhomogeneous cooling in these viscoelastic gases. I'm just going to give you a few representative results. This will coming out in PRL shortly. The first thing is, remember the first thing in the homogeneous cooling state was how the system cools with time. And in my gas with constant E, my temperature went down as T raised to the power minus 2. Okay, this is a half cooling law. Well, you can actually obtain the corresponding cooling law in this case also. And we have arguments supported by our MD results, which show that the temperature cools with time as T raised to the power minus 5 by 3. It was earlier minus 2. It's now minus 5 by 3. This, I emphasize, is real time and not the collision time. So now I'm talking again in terms of the real time of the evolving viscoelastic gas. Okay, we've also done inelastic kinetic theory for these viscoelastic gases. And with that uglier expression of E, the viscoelastic, the inelastic kinetic theory is correspondingly more difficult. But we can actually obtain the velocity distributions in the homogeneous cooling state characterized by these Sonin coefficients A2 and A3. And here's a sort of sub-representative results. Here's A2, That's the first non-trivial Sonin coefficient as a function of time for some value of the viscoelasticity. I start off with my homogeneous state at time t equal to 0 in a sort of Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, so A2 is 0. Then the system sort of evolves away. As it cools, it starts to revert to the elastic limit. And so that the circles are our MD simulation results, and our inelastic kinetic theory goes right through it. Okay. Keep in mind that this reversion of A2 to 0 is not a result of crossing over to the inhomogeneous cooling state. It's a consequence of the fact that as the system cools and the relative velocity becomes less and less, the collision, the sort of restitution coefficient E becomes closer and closer to elastic. Okay. Similarly, we've also calculated A3, and again, we have an excellent agreement with our sort of MD results. So this is A3 as a function of time. I start off with a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, so I have A3 equal to 0. The circles are my MD results, and the sort of solid line is the result from my inelastic kinetic theory. Okay, so that actually brings me to my conclusion. So let me just sort of, I've covered sort of various aspects of the problem, but the most important one I want to emphasize is that in the dynamical properties of granular matter, inelastic collisions lead to aggregation. So generically, soft objects aggregate. Okay, that's what we've learned. And the aggregation is a consequence of these correlations that build up when the collisions take place. We've been able to model many of these growth situations by Kahn-Hilliard or related equations. Kahn-Hilliard equations, of course, require an inelasticity. Kahn-Hilliard equations require surface tension, which makes it expensive for defects to be around, and therefore they must be removed. And in this case, the surface tension arises kinetically from this restitution coefficient, which deviates from 1. Okay, so that's sort of the most important part of it. Let me just run through what I said out here. Well, I've already said that, I think, that the freely evolving granular gas exhibits aggregation and clustering in the density and velocity fields. This is purely kinetic. Okay, it has nothing to do with intermolecular potentials, which are not relevant in this case. Okay, the velocity distributions are non-Maxwell-Boltzmann in the homogeneous cooling state. We understand how to characterize these as an expansion around a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution using these Sonin coefficients, using the Sonin polynomials and the corresponding Sonin coefficients. We expect that the velocity distribution should revert to Maxwellian in the inhomogeneous cooling state, because you simply have a large number of randomly oriented clusters where particles are sort of moving parallel to each other. Okay, our numerics has not shown that as yet. Okay. I didn't make observations about long time tails. Let me just say it in this concluding transparency. If I look at the velocity autocorrelation functions for elastic hard spheres, one of the important early results was that of Alder and Wainwright. And the Alder-Wainwright result was that the velocity autocorrelation function decays as t raised to power minus d by 2, where d is the dimensionality. Okay. We actually find that this, and this has generated a certain amount of interest in this particular aspect, that the velocity autocorrelation function in the granular gas decays as tau raised to power minus d by 2, where tau is the collision time. Okay. So the Alder-Wainwright result generalizes naturally. Once you account for the fact that the system is becoming more sluggish and mean square velocities are going down with time. Okay. Okay, my last observation is this is relevant because this is the work we've been doing with my student Anuja and my collaborator Devang Khakkar. So far, of course, I've talked only about very simple granular gases, same size, same shape, etc., etc. We're now starting, we have looked at polydispersed systems. We've looked at, for example, mixtures with two different masses. And if the masses are vastly different, you can have sort of very interesting morphologies with cages formed by one set of particles and sort of the smaller particles rattling around in those cages. We also looked at particles with different sizes. Again, there's a whole sort of a set of new problems which arise, and we're now beginning to understand some of these. Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Since you mentioned the Half's law in the homogeneous cooling limit, so do all these curves have any specific power laws in the inhomogeneous limit as well?
As a matter of fact, they do. And there are mode coupling arguments, first given by Matthew Ernst and company, and then Subir and I had also looked at this. Sorry, let me just get back to it. Yeah, so that's my test of how the temperature goes with time. One finds that at late times, the temperature cools as tau raised to power minus d by 2, where d is the dimensionality. Okay, and then the coefficient is dependent on E, as a matter of fact, or the time scale is dependent on E. So yes, one understands the late stage decay also. We have not done the corresponding argument for the viscoelastic case, okay? Because as I said, the viscoelastic case is complicated by the fact that as I proceed further in the process, it starts to become more and more elastic. So that sort of complicates things slightly. So we haven't done the corresponding calculation for the viscoelastic granular gas.
Any other questions or comment?
So it's not really my field, so this will be very ignorant. I apologize, but you seem to show plots that look like the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution for your granular system.
That's right.
And, yeah, okay. So what I'm curious about is, over time, this should change, right? And you've got your longest time is your highest value of elasticity, and then at E equals 0.7, you've got T equals 1. What happens if you go to longer times? Can you capture what it does?
So this is the point I was stressing. I didn't stress enough. Let me sort of re-stress it. The inelastic Boltzmann equation, which we use as the basis for calculating these velocity distributions, applies only as long as the system is homogeneous. So these times are specifically chosen to lie in the homogeneous cooling state, which is why I've picked earlier and earlier times for larger and larger values of the inelasticity, because then I onset the inhomogeneous cooling state earlier if E is further away from 1. Okay, for the inhomogeneous cooling state, I only have the following hand-waving argument, that the inhomogeneous cooling state, In the inhomogeneous cooling state, as characterized by this last snapshot out here, I have large clusters of particles, and then there are regions where there's no particles at all. And in each one of these clusters, the particles are moving approximately parallel to each other. They've parallelized by this time, so there's sort of no further loss of energy inside the clusters. So I have this sort of hand-waving argument that just because you have so many randomly oriented clusters moving in arbitrary directions, the overall velocity distribution should be a Gaussian. Okay, but it's not been seen numerically yet. People do more sophisticated things, like trying to treat this as a mix of a denser gas and a rarer gas, and then try to write down the velocity distributions using the inelastic Boltzmann equation for two different densities.
Okay.
But I'm not sure that's valid, because I don't think it's a gas anymore in these clustered regions. Yeah.
And briefly, if you drive it, you maintain a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution?
Not at all.
Or you can calculate what it is if you drive it?
Not so easy. We can try to calculate. But typically when you drive it, you are sort of agitating the system from a boundary. If you rotate it in a drum, you're agitating it from the boundary of the drum. If you vibrate it on a plate, you're only energizing the particles which are hitting the plate. Okay, so to work that sort of realistic agitation into your calculation is difficult. People have looked at mock models where you thermostat the system throughout uniformly. In that case, we can do calculations with inelastic kinetic theory. Okay,
thank you.
But those are not so realistic, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. So any other question? Yeah. Good.
You know, you're doing the calculations only with spherical particles, right?
That's right, yeah.
If you have needles,
yeah.
So in the patches there, mm-hmm. you'll have kind of pneumatic ordering, right?
Yeah, that's perfectly correct, yes.
So can you characterize that in some sense? Did you have any calculations?
We have started to do studies of that system. There are numerical simulations of cooling needles or cooling rods. But we're now trying to do the inelastic kinetic theory of that. It's much harder. Yeah.
And so where is the information about the shape encoded?
Sorry, let me just add one more thing. If you're looking at a rod, you would cool in the translational velocity, and you would cool in the rotational velocity also. And the cooling could be different for the mean squared translational velocity and the mean squared rotational velocity.
So in some sense, you'll have two temperatures in the system.
You would have two Hough's laws which govern the decay of rotational and kinetic degrees of freedom.
Sanjay. Have you looked at looked at the transition between unclustered and the onset of clustering? Can you comment on this? Right, when you is that
well,
have you analyzed in terms of?
No, that's a very interesting question. Let me just go back to my granular material in a drum, the mixture in a drum. Here, I find that the equation that I define an order parameter. The order parameter is the density difference in the two species, etc. Just as usual, the drive to segregate is because a rough material likes to have a steeper slope and a smooth material likes to have a lesser slope, basically. And if I write down the corresponding equations, I get something very much like the Kahn-Hilliard equation. So the crossover from, in that case, from sort of the homogeneous state is very much like a Kahn-Hilliard-Cook evolution, as a matter of fact.
Right.
Except, yeah, the surface tension is inelasticity in this
case. Right. I can understand for the mixture, but for the inhomogeneous.
The inhomogeneous cooling state is also, in our way of thinking of it, it's a mixture. It's a lattice gas, right? Okay. It's a mixture of vacancies and the granular part.
So, you know, you are the expert, right? So, do you believe that the critical exponents at that juncture would be the same universality class?
I won't bet money on it because this is an extremely non-equilibrium situation, right? I mean, you're losing energy, you're sort of, in some cases, exciting it, not in this particular one, but it has, strangely enough, beautiful analogies to usual phase separation problems. Yeah. maybe it's a statement that the techniques one has developed in phase ordering, where one treats these defects as paramount and the defect dynamics as paramount, these techniques are so robust, the principles are so robust, that any situation where you have interfaces or where you have vortices, anti-vortices, would be described by the same sort of...
No, I think the remark that you are making now is very exciting, right?
Yeah.
These are more like a topological defect.
That's right.
Right, than the simple phase transitions, equilibrium phase transitions. So these may belong to a different university class. I think it will be very worthwhile to nail down the criticality at that point, because these occur in many, many, you know, strings, cosmological.
That's right. Okay. Thanks.
In the other case, depending on the order parameter you have, you can have topological defects that are slow in a way that's similar to this.
So, for example, in the superconductor, you have a two-component order parameter, which is this local phase angle. Or in the Heisenberg model, you can have monopoles and anti-monopoles and so on and so forth. Yeah, we have, Alan Bray and I looked at a lot of those.
So this might be analogous to a non-equilibrium Costolis-Taulis kind of transition?
Yeah. That's we find that the correlation functions and the structure factors of these are identical, numerically equivalent to those obtained by Alan Bray and myself for the ordering of superconductors, superfluids, etc.
I see. Yeah.
And the sort of physics that goes into it is simply that these vortices and anti-vortices kill each other.
Yeah, they have to annihilate.
They cost energy. Here they don't cost energy, but here they like to sort of become parallel to each other.
Yeah. Are there any other questions? I just had one about, you know, you had those colored stripes.
Yeah.
In Martin sites, you also get some kind of twinning. And there, of course, it's a completely different physical system. But there is a scaling between the width and the length of the system. The width goes like L to the half, sort of. Is there, if I take a longer system, does the width change or not?
No, actually, in this case, the width grows with time. It's a it's a growth. It's growing.
It's not a steady state.
And with our analogy with the 1D phase separation, we argue that it should go logarithmically with time. And as a matter of fact, that's what the experiments do find. Well, they don't have a very large interval of time, but on that on the intervals they do have, they find they go logarithmically. So ultimately, this will all become half sand and half glass, as a matter.
Okay. Okay, so if there's no other questions, this is the end of a very nice talk and stimulating discussion. Let's thank our speaker again.